O Lord, you're beautiful. Your face is all I seek. And when your when your eyes are on this child, O Lord, please light the fire that once burned bright and clear. That's the word of God this morning. I don't think there's one in the house for whom the Lord burnt bright and clear, perhaps even clearer than today. Well, you've had times in the past where the light's been a lot clearer and it's dulled and it's become bright again. Oh Lord, please light the fire that once burned bright and clear. We've had some powerful words spoken over this house in recent weeks and months, and the word from Pastor Al Hooten that the Lord wants to visit with us is almost scary. And I felt the Lord saying to me all week, I want you to speak into that. And I said to the Lord so many times, I can't do that. And he said, you will. You do as you're told. Well, I try to do as I'm told. I really do. Mel knows I try to do as I'm told. The word was a simple word. I am coming to visit them. And I'm going to activate the heart of David in this people. In this people. Who is this people? Look at yourself in the mirror and say, I'm this people. Yes, I'm this people. You are this people. I wonder if that's not a word that some people don't believe. There are a number of promises in the scripture that I find they're words that some Christians don't believe. Jesus said that the things that I do, you will do, and greater things. Oh, give me a break. That's not possible. One of the greatest promises that many Christians don't believe. But he meant it. Jesus was limited in time and space. The church is all over the world. No longer limited in time and space, I know, but on the earth he was limited to time and space. And so he was saying that whilst I did a lot where I was in one place at one time, when my church is universal all across the world, you will do greater things. You will do greater things. One shall put 10,000 to flight, or 1,000 to flight, and two 10,000 to flight. How many will 2 billion put to flight if we'd only believe what God says? This people in the building today, people who belong to this fellowship today, you and me, I'm going to activate the heart of David in this people. Pastor Neil said we all have a part to play, and he meant it. I don't think I've heard a pastor enunciate more than Neil does to say it's not all about me. So many pastors in this day and age, it seems to be all about them. But we are blessed that the leadership of this house is not all about a man, it's all about God. And he means it when he says it's all about us. It's all about us. We all have a part to play. And I don't know whether how closely you listen or whether you go back to the web. I think the videoing of the meetings and putting them up on the web is such a wonderful blessing to go back and have another think about that word that was given. And Neil made the point of saying, as you were reflecting on what Al Hooten had to say, he made a point of saying only a couple of weeks before he'd made some notes and God had said to him, I will visit this church. Well, you tuck that away until God does what he does, confirms it by two or three witnesses. Same word. He said, I wrote down, I will activate the heart of David in this house. I find that extraordinary, but it's God. That's our God. We all have a part to play. But you know the enemy opposes that word? The enemy opposes that word. And he comes to you and he comes to me and he gives us 1,000 good reasons why it can't mean me. Isn't that true? I'm too old, I'm too wrinkly, I'm too achy, I'm too... I went to the working bee on Friday. I went home sick, had a cup of tea and a Bex and a good lie down. I'm not as young as I used to be. And I hear that it was reported by somebody that I look green around the gills. I had all the best intentions in the world. I had a great excuse for leaving the working bee. I wasn't looking for an excuse. And I'm not looking for an excuse now when God says, I want to use you. And yet I want to tell you most probably 1,000 times this week the enemy has said, you've got no right to preach. I know all about you, Chris Pack. I can remind a few people some things about you. And then I turn to the Word, and the Word says he's cast the record of sinfulness into the sea of his forgetfulness, never to be remembered against me anymore. Enemy, go to hell wherever you belong. You might remember, but he's forgotten. He's forgotten. There's a calling on my life and I'm pressing into it. It's as simple as that. I mightn't be 18 or 20 when I first was called. I'll never forget the day. It was as clear as crystal when God said, I want you. And to this day, I'm not going back on that. That calling is as real today as ever it was. I might be, but I'm... The call is as alive in my life as ever. As alive in my life as ever. And yet the enemy comes to us and says, oh, I know it's a lovely word. I'm going to activate the heart of David. I want to visit this house. And then he gives us 1,000 reasons why. There's nothing we can do. Not my gifting, not my this, not that, not something else. Well, I want to tell you something this morning, and it comes right from the throne room. God's not listening to that nonsense. Well, I will. God's not listening to that nonsense. In fact, I'll give it a word. It's stinking thinking. Stinking thinking. My father came back to the Lord on his deathbed. He was 69, something like that, when he came back to the Lord on his deathbed. He'd been a minister of the gospel. He became a serious backslider. When I was 10, my mother went to England for 5 months to a great conference of women. It was the days of the Suez Crisis. Couldn't sail through the Suez. It meant that you went by sea because flying by plane was only for the mega rich. So 4 weeks to England became 5.5. She was on the first boat that came through the Suez in the very first convoy after it had been reopened. She was gone for 5 months. My father was a backslider. It was a very difficult time in my life. I'm not going into that. But every week during those 5 months, an old retired pastor and his wife, who'd known Dad when he was in the ministry and functioning well, would knock on the door and say, Harold, we just come to say hello, checking up on you. How's Grace doing? She's having a good time in England. Oh, by the way, here's a fruitcake. Fifteen years later, he came back to the Lord on his deathbed. Who brought him back to the Lord? The old pastor who brought him a fruitcake. You say, I haven't got the gifting. You got the gift of hospitality? You can bake a cake? Don't tell me God's not saying, it's for you today. It's for you today. I am going to visit this house and activate the heart of David in this people. In this people. I look into the Bible at James 5:17. And I have to say to myself, stop looking at human perspective. Stop looking at human perspective. James 5:17. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours. Oh, yes. He was one of the mega... No, he wasn't. According to this word, he was a man just like you and me. Elijah was a man just like us. And he prayed earnestly that it would not rain. And it did not rain on the land for 3 years and 6 months. A man just like us. If you know the story of Elijah, you'll know how powerful he was, but you'll also know that he spat the dummy big time. He knew how to spit the dummy, did Elijah. And God went after him and said to him, Elijah, what on earth are you doing here? Where was here? He was hiding in a cave. Running from a woman. Well, he might have got that bit right. She was some woman, was Jezebel. Her name has come to stand for a divisive spirit in a church. I've run up against the spirit of Jezebel, and it's not a nice spirit. But what was Elijah doing in the cave, running from Jezebel, when he just defeated all her prophets? Spitting the dummy. He was a man just like us. I can spit the dummy. Can't you? Few dummy spitters in the house. Look at God's perspective. A man just like us. God's not saying, oh, I remember Elijah, he's a dummy spitter. No, he's saying, I remember Elijah. He's a man just like us, and I used him. He prayed and I listened to his prayer. He prayed and I listened to his prayer. Yeah, man, just like you. You pray and I'll listen to your prayer. Ephesians 3:20, Neil's been quoting it again and again. Here's another promise that we struggle to believe. The exceedingly abundantly. Listen to it in the voice. David's introduced me to the voice. Forced me to buy another Bible to go with the 27 others I've got. But I'm glad he did. Ephesians 3:20 in the voice, the exceedingly abundantly. Now to him who has many awe-inspiring things, immeasurable things, things greater than we could ever ask or imagine. You say to me, Chris, this prophetic word over this house, I can't imagine how it could possibly be. Good, it must be God. Because that's his exceeding abundance. It's above what I can ask or think or imagine. I can't imagine how God can use us. I can't. But it's not up to my imagination. It's up to God. Do you believe me today? Believe me today. I've been asking the Lord, is there a particular word? And the word release has been on my mind, but in a sense it's coming to me, even as I share the word this morning, perhaps it's to break the spirit of unbelief. I suspect that this is one of the great and powerful promises most Christians actually don't believe. We use it to our own words to explain it away. We let others talk us down. Neil's been talking about the power of words, how they can destroy us and how they can destroy others. I don't need your help to talk me down. I can talk myself down very well indeed. I really can. In his backslidden state, my father called me names that I can never repeat. But I have a go at times to remind myself that's who I am. And God says, for heaven's sake, Chris, that's not who you are. That's not who you are. We were looking at James in our studies on Thursday nights, and Neil said some kind things about them, but we really are having a great time. Seeing the word in a new way. Not a new word, but just seeing it more clearly. And James says the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity, a great fire. See how great a forest a little fire kindles. Oh, the tongue, again from the voice, is a world of iniquity. A world of iniquity. And this verse goes on to say, out of the same mouth proceed blessing and cursing. These things ought not to be. If God speaks a promise over us, if God speaks a prophetic word into our life and says, I am going to visit this house and activate the heart of David in this house, we do him a great injustice if we allow the tongue to talk it down. We really do. We really do. And all we do is we agree with the enemy rather than with God. And quite frankly, I'm sick and tired of being in agreement with the enemy. Quite frankly. The fact is, God wants to use you. The fact is, God wants to use me. With all your weaknesses and inadequacies, you don't need to tell God how many aches and pains you've got. He can number them. I went to the hairdresser and got a haircut. And my options are getting less and less. Some of you have got no options at all. But my options are getting less and less. And some of you are making it much easier for God to number the hairs on your head. But use the statistic, but he's got it. Do you think he doesn't know how weak and insecure and how feeble you are and how rickety you are even with a stick? Give me a break. And yet he still says, this people. Do you know that most probably the largest unevangelized field in this country is not the young, it's not the middle-aged, it's not the yuppies, it's not something else, it's our generation? Where are all the Sunday school kids who've never come to anything? Our generation. God wants to use you. He loves to use weak and fallible people. Because when he does, there's only one explanation. It was God. It was God. My question, why does God use so many fallible people to accomplish his purposes on earth? Because he's got no other kind. No other kind. Oh, God, you don't know how weak and fallible I am. Yes, I do. There's 6 billion of you. I know exactly how weak and fallible you are. And quite frankly, I want to use you. I'm looking for your kind because when I do stuff, there's only one explanation. It was me. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 11, the heroes of the faith. I love going here, and I'm not being rude about them, but I love going here. What a motley crew. Honestly. Hebrews 11:8, Abraham, by faith Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place which he would receive as an inheritance, and he went out not knowing where he was going. Sounds familiar? Abraham, the great giant of faith, couldn't believe God when God said, I'm going to give you a son. And the greatest crisis this planet has ever faced is now because of Abraham. Excuse me? If Abraham didn't have Ishmael, well, we wouldn't have ISIS. It's really as simple as that. Now, I'm not having a go at Abraham because he is the friend of God. And if God was to put that epitaph on my gravestone, I'd be a very happy man. But he was a man just like us who struggled to believe, even though he's the father of them who believe. Verse 11, this makes me scream. Verse 11 of Hebrews chapter 11. By faith, Sarah, give me a break. If ever there was an unbeliever, it was Sarah. Truly. Abraham, I'm too old. And what's more, I don't like it. You're going to have to go and find somebody who might like it. I've got a maid, you can have her. Hope she likes it. Hope you get a son. You think I'm joking? I think I'm right. 1,000 excuses why it couldn't be. And God said, no, Sarah, it's going to be your child out of your womb. you're going to come alive. It's tempting to ask you to look at somebody and say, you're going to come alive. But when the child was born, the child was called Isaac. Why? Because she laughed at the promise of God. By faith, Sarah. That's how God sees her, woman of faith. Verse 23, Hebrews chapter 11, verse 23, by faith, Moses. Well, great man of God, not allowed to enter the promised land because of anger. Talk about Elijah spitting the dummy. Moses did it big time. So big that God said, Moses, because of that, because you've not honored me in front of my people, you are not entering the promised land. And yet when the heroes of the faith are recorded, Moses. Moses. Verse 31. By faith, Rahab. Oh, come on now. Clean up your act, girl. You're only scared. That's the only reason you helped the Hebrews. She became a forebear of Jesus. She is in the Matthew lineage, a genealogy of Jesus. Well, we don't have those kind of people in the church. Well, God has them in the kingdom. God has them in the kingdom. God has them in the kingdom. By faith, the harlot doesn't even mince words about her. By faith, the prostitute, Rahab. Verse 32. What more shall I say? For time would fail me to tell of Gideon, the man with 70 sons. Didn't come from one woman. Why am I saying this? Because I'm wanting to... No. I want to remind you that God's perspective is very different to ours. Gideon answered the call of God at a critical time, a strategic time in the life of the nation, and that's what God remembers. That's what God remembers. The book of Judges, I haven't got this scripture, so don't worry about it, but Judges 8:33, he made no lasting impact. Excuse me, he did. But the writer of the Judges didn't think he did, but God does, by faith, Gideon. By faith, Barak. By faith, Deborah and Barak. Barak was called to lead the army of God into battle. And he went to the prophetess Deborah and he said to Deborah, I'm not going to battle without you. I'd be scared to go into battle unless you were with me holding my little hand. Please. I'm scared. Please come with me. And Deborah said, well, that's all right, Barak. I'll come with you, but they're going to recognize me rather than you. By faith, Barak. By faith, Jephthah, son of a harlot. Book of Judges calls him the leader of a band of worthless men. By faith, Samson. Excuse me, Samson? Is he on that list? He is. Samson. Well, and also David, just a throwaway word, and also David, the best known adulterer and murderer in the Bible. 1 Samuel 13:14 says this of David. See what it says. 1 Samuel 13:14. Now, this is a word to Saul. Your kingdom shall not continue. The Lord has sought for himself a man after his own heart, and the Lord has commanded him to be commander over his people. The Lord has sought for a man after his own heart. And Acts 13:22 says of David that he was a man after God's own heart. a man after God's own heart. My comments are not taking a holier-than-thou attitude to these people. Don't get me wrong. I'm simply trying to make a point. When you start saying to God, God, it's a lovely word, but it's not for me. God is saying, for heaven's sake, read the book. Read the book. I use people like you. I use people like you. The picture in the New Testament, the two greatest characters of the New Testament after Jesus himself are undoubtedly Peter and Paul. Go to Galatians 2, chapter 2, verse 11 and 12. They're at the same love feast, church meal. They're going to celebrate communion. And Peter turns up and discovers that there's some Jews in the church at Galatia. So what's he do? He gets them all together and they sit together as a clique. And Paul challenges him to his face. I withstood him to his face because he was to be blamed. The message says they had a face-to-face confrontation. I don't think it was a pretty moment. I honestly don't think it was a pretty moment. I've had one or two of them. You find that hard to believe. I know I'm so likable. But I've had one or two of them. And God says, Paul, you're mine. I'm going to use you. God says, Peter, you're mine. I'm going to use you. Thursday night in our class, we were looking at this next one, Acts 15:39. Paul gets the idea that it's time to go again to the churches that he planted on the first missionary journey. He's about to embark on the second missionary journey. And he says to Barnabas, now come on, brother, let's go, let's go. And Barnabas says, I want to take John Mark with me. Now, John Mark, the writer of our Gospel of Mark, had been with Paul and Barnabas on the first missionary journey. And for reasons we're not told, he left and went home to Mum. He did, literally. Went home to Mum. And whatever the reason was, it stuck in Paul's craw. Big time. And when Barney said, Paul, we're going to take old Jono. You know, young Jono, Mark, we're going to take him along on this. He wants to come, you know. Well, he's not coming with me. Then the contention became so sharp. These are two of the great saints. The contention became so sharp. The message says, tempers flared. I'm just making a point. I hope I'm making a strong point this morning. Ooh. People, we've got to be done with the excuses. If the Lord says to you and to me, I am going to visit this house, then he plans to do it while you're here. He's not going to engineer for you not to be here that day. He wants you to be here, perhaps today. I'm going to visit this house and activate the heart of David in this people. Let me very quickly just take a couple of minutes to run through Paul. Paul is an interesting study. And we've got the scriptures up there. In Galatians chapter 2, which was one of the oldest books of the New Testament, possibly the earliest, that with James, written around about the same time, AD 47, 48, somewhere around about there, only 15 to 18 years after the death of Jesus. Paul writes to the Galatians because he planted a church there, and when he gets back to Antioch, he hears rumors that some Jewish people had gone in, and these Christians, these Gentile Christians who knew nothing of Jewish law, had been persuaded to become Jews and get circumcised and observe Jewish law. And Paul was, to put it mildly, furious, absolutely furious. And if you read the book of Galatians the way it was actually written, you'll read some of his anger. Stand fast in the liberty wherewith Christ has made you free. No, stand fast in the liberty wherewith Christ has made you free, and do not be entangled again in the yoke of bondage. And then he has to say, oh, I wish I could come to you and say this to your face, because I know it sounds harsh on paper. You've got that right. It sounds very aggressive on paper. But he tells in Galatians 2 and verse 6, did I not give you that scripture? I did, verse 6. He went to Jerusalem on one occasion, not for the Jerusalem council, but before this. And he went to talk with the apostles about the things that he'd learned from God when he was in the wilderness being taught by the Holy Spirit. And he says, I went there and I talked with them, but from those who seemed to be something, that's not a very nice thing to say about Peter and James and John. And those who seemed to be something, whatever they were, it makes no difference to, come on now. God shows personal favoritism to no man. For those who seemed to be something added nothing to me. Now, I know what he was actually saying. What he was saying was, it turned out that the Holy Spirit had really got hold of my head and turned my heart, and we were on the same page. That's what he was saying. But that's a pretty clumsy way to say it, isn't it? Those big shots down in Jerusalem, they couldn't teach me anything. When he writes 1 Corinthians chapter 15, possibly 6 or 8 years later, he says this, then last of all he was seen by me also, as by one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles, who am not worthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. That's a change of attitude. That's a change of heart. We'll see a bit more in a moment, but I want to say this. I think we've established that God wants to use people like you and me, but God also wants us to grow up. Can I be that blunt? God wants us to grow up. I've had to do some growing up big time. I really have. I've had to do some big time growing up, just as well. God still uses us. God still uses us even while we're growing up. God used him, Paul, in Galatia, even though he had this strange way of expressing himself. But by the time he gets to write to the Corinthians, the work of grace in his life is really taking hold of this arrogant Pharisee and softening him, toning him down, and helping him to realize those brothers that I met with, I'm actually the least of them. I'm not even an equal. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And I love this. And his grace toward me was not in vain. Oh, I trust that you could say that today. His grace toward you has not been in vain. God's tolerated stuff from this boy. And I'm thankful that he changed me so much. There's a lot more changing to go. But he's changed me so much that his grace has not been in vain. Let's have a look at another scripture to do with Paul. 2 Corinthians 11. Oh, Paul. This is only perhaps 12 months later, he writes this letter, and it's almost as if he slipped backwards. 2 Corinthians 11, verse 5. I consider that I am not at all inferior to the most eminent apostles. I thought we'd got that out of your system, Paul. Do you ever have days when the old you flares? Yes. He still wants to use you. He was using Paul big time. While Paul was still growing up, he was using him mightily. I wouldn't use the word mightily, but I know that while I've been growing up, God has still used me. Aren't you glad about that? But let's go to Ephesians 3:8. Perhaps 3 or 4 years later, AD 60, somewhere around about there. Ephesians 3:8, to me, who am less than the least of all the saints. Not even talking about the apostles anymore. He's less than the least of all the saints. He's saying when he comes into this room, guys, you're so better than me. Wow. That's a change of heart, isn't it? No, it's spiritual maturity. That's what it is. It's spiritual maturity. Two more quickly. Philippians 3, verse 12. Philippians 3 and verse 12. It's coming. You'll be there in a moment. Not that I've already attained or am already perfect, but I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has laid hold of me. Not attained, not perfect, but I'm hanging on. I'm hanging on. I'm hanging on. I could sit in that chair right now and say, I'm here because I'm hanging on. I'm here because I'm hanging on. Not attained, not perfect. Mel's lived with me for over 44 years. She knows I'm not perfect. I say this without carrying on. She's been like Jesus to me. And I've been anything but. But she's hung on. How much more does he hang on? How much more does he hang on? Least of all the saints, says Paul. And the famous last one is 1 Timothy 1:15. This is a faithful saying, worthy of all acceptance, that Christ Jesus came in the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Far cry from those apostles down there, those bigwigs in Jerusalem, couldn't teach me anything. He's now the greatest of sinners. Well, the enemy says to me time and time again, you only think you're going to heaven. You're too dirty, you're going to miss out. And God says, excuse me. The enemy gets up to the throne room because the Bible says he's the accuser of the brethren. And for some reason, he gets access to the Father and he says to the Father, that Chris Pack, he's got no place in this place. And the Father's about to say, oh, is that right? When Jesus chips in and says, excuse me, he's on my list. Jesus, before the devil can go any further, Jesus chips in and says, excuse me, he's on my list. Have you thought about that? The enemy knows what you've been up to. The enemy knows. He's a great accuser, but he's not being listened to because you're on Jesus' list. He can accuse you as much as he likes, but you're on the Lord's list. And that's all the Father needs to know. The enemy has a go and he turns to Jesus, and Jesus only has to give him a wink or a nod, and the Father says, forget it. My boy knows him. My boy knows him. Good enough for me. My boy knows him. I'll keep him on. Oh God. We're having fun in church this morning. But some of you are laughing because you don't want to cry. Because you know that what I'm saying is the truth. And it's time that some of us, if not all of us, started stop harking back to who we've been and what we were and start saying, I'm going to accept the verdict of God. My boy knows me. That's the verdict of the Father. My boy knows me. That's the Father's verdict. And you know what? That's all that matters. You see, we can complicate getting into the kingdom as much as we like, but the bottom line is, if we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in his heart, our heart, that God's raised him from the dead, we're saved. And we're on the list. And if we're on the boy's list, that's all Daddy needs to know. Because those on the list are Daddy's kids. Do you know what? You don't forget your kids. You don't forget your kids. You don't forget your kids. Oh, there's a lot more I could say, but it's time to stop. But I'm going to say this, and I don't know whether you're just going to sit there or whether you're really going to have to get up and come this morning. There's some great ministry in this house. I know we're missing our pastor, but I want to say, and I say this with all the reverence in my heart, the anointing in this house is not Neil Myers, it's the Holy Ghost. And that anointing is present in this house today, and that anointing, according to the book, is on you and you and you and on me. You have an anointing from the Holy Ghost. And there is some significant ministry in this house that will minister in Jesus' name today. And if you want prayer, today is a day to break something over your life. If you're listening too much to the enemy, don't be afraid to admit it. Stick it in his face and come and get released today. Stick it in his face and come and get released today. It's breakthrough day. It's breakthrough day. From now on, I'm going to remember, enemy, Daddy's checked and I'm on the boys' list. I like that. I like that. Daddy's checked and I'm on the boys' list. Daddy's checked and I'm on the boys' list. So time to tell the enemy, Daddy's checked and you're on the list. And if you need a breakthrough to get that into your spirit and get the other nonsense out, or for whatever reason, there are people here who are very happy to lay hands on you and pray and seek freedom and release. Or if today is just a day when you're saying, I feel today is a day when I just want to mark the moment and press on further. Well, why don't you come? Why don't you come? You come while the musos lead.
I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
You're a child of God. You're on Daddy's list.
I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
I'm no longer.
You come. You come.
I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child.
This little man.